can have an old lady go out here and make a goddamn song in this goddamn place right across the street here and come right out and she shoot a video and motherfuckers be like, yo, did you see that old lady puffing that weed doing that beat? That beat was hot. And she'd be the hottest new bitch on the motherfucking scene.
What would her name be?
Grandma Lemon Tits.
Yeah.
Red, what's good? Thank you for your time and talent, brother.
Thank you, my brother.
All right, all right. Over here on your set today, got to see you mingle with some hardcore Redman fans.
Yeah.
What was that like today, man?
Just allowing the fans to be a part of your entity. Mm-hmm. They love it and appreciate it because you take the time to reach out. And anytime you give back a reach out, you always get a great execution. So I didn't need that many fans, but I needed some fans for this certain scene. And they were mostly young.
Yeah.
And see, that's what the fuck I appreciate mostly, that, you know, out of all the new music that's going on out here, they still appreciate a 90s dude like me that's still putting work. And it showed in their actions. I appreciate them for coming through.
I think seeing the fact that you were interacting with them, though, that was the part that was dope. Because when one of them, they brought out his phone, and he was like, yo, you know what it is, you know what it is. And then you got hyped right with him. I think it shocked him.
Right.
Like, he knew you was going to, you know, interact, but it kind of shocked him. And he was like, that's right, man, we here for the 90s.
That's right.
What's so important and so grounding to you with the 90s?
What's important to me about still grinding and pushing that 90s feel is that we still have an audience for it. And our core audience from the 90s have grown with us.
Redman, what's the sound? I tell a motherfucker 1990 now. I said slap your hands, everybody. Cause I brought weed for everybody.
To still love music entirely. And it's not like their ears was just shut off from 90s music after our music, you know, kind of faded but didn't.
In theory.
But they wasn't turned on with the new music, mostly of the new music of the masses, to be like, wow, okay, this new music made me forget about listening to the 90s dudes. I have them in my classics. Our era of people grew to just be like, wow, okay, nothing really give us eargasms but this 90s music.
What was funny was like, y'all had the door closed to the green room, and y'all was knocking like the old funk joints, like 1970s and everything like that. It was getting busy.
Absolutely. You gotta play classics. Like when I'm on a video set, I have to have my own speaker in my room, in my green room, to smoke and vibe out. And I don't vibe out to my songs. I vibe out to just old classic shit. Yeah. And I get prepared, you know? It gets my heart ready for performance.
I think what people will probably even either not know or will forget is that you're a DJ.
Yeah, I started off as a DJ.
Yeah, and for who?
I started off just DJing because I always wanted a DJ. And then my first, like, real artist who I DJed for was for Do It All Do.
Yep.
From Lords of the Underground.
Lords of the Underground.
I mean, because he was my boy and lived right in back of me. Like, my house was here and his house was right in back of me. Mm-hmm. And we used to get money and do music. And he was definitely hot in the streets, I would say, at that time. Just as a regular artist coming out the hood, everyone knew him in our neighborhood. So we used to do shows and we used to drive to Atlantic City to do shows with Diesel Don. You know, that's another comrade of mine. But yeah. My first gig was with Do It All Do as a DJ.
And what was your DJ name?
My DJ name was Cut Killer.
MC Fudd, and yo, I definitely can't forget all our posses from Jersey. That's Money D Productions, 4D, Cut Killer.
Yeah, my DJ name is Cut Killer. You know, I always just would DJ. And then when I got down with EPMD, I DJed for Dos FX a couple of times. And I used to DJ for Solo for a while.
Wow, man. Yeah. People used to think y'all was brothers and all of that for a minute.
Yeah, that's my brother from another mother. We born on the same day. Our connection is just like beyond brotherhood. Like we brothers in this game. We brothers in personal life. And you know, sometimes you can have people, you know, in your life that's just friends, that's closer to you than family, you know?
All the way.
So you know, he's one of those dudes I respect as a brother and listen to because he's older than me. And he taught me a lot, you know, about the game and when I was coming out. He taught me a whole lot, really, like.
And a lot of times when you say it like that, you say that you learn from people that you're around that might be a little bit older than you, but they don't necessarily have to always say it like you're watching them. Was it a lot of that for you with K-Solo?
It was a lot of watching what to do and also what not to do. Mm. You know, sometimes you can learn from other people's mistakes. Yeah. It was a lot of verbal, mostly verbal. He's a funny dude. K-Solo is, you know, if you don't know K-Solo, K-Solo is hilarious. Keith Murray, my crew is hilarious. From Keith Murray on down, they hilarious. But yep. K-Solo, he got his own way of explaining his philosophy.
Okay.
And I crack up every time, but then I experience it. Mm. And it's like, you know, wow. Even though, bruh, sound like he crazy when he talking, but he definitely is on point with his language. So I gotta respect, bruh. You know, big up the Solo.
I mean, I was gonna wait, but you already kind of introduced the crew already. You already said Das, you already said EPMD, K-Solo and Keith Murray. I mean, the legendary Hit Squad. Mm-hmm. What you guys did as far as like, every time I hear Hit Squad, I think hustlers and hardcore, you feel it.
Right.
When y'all got together, what was that like for all of y'all to get together and have that energy when y'all all on stage together?
Well, back then, for the Hit Squad to be on stage, for the Hit Squad to be on tour, period, it was, I would say it was very energetic because we was like the first crew to have, you know, different artists to come together them and make a super group. Mm-hmm. We was like the first, you know, crew besides Juice Crew. You know, at that time, Das FX was selling a million records. Like, that was like when NWA was out here, did a million. Like, Das FX did a million records in 91. And EPMD was already a household name for going gold and 800,000, 900,000, close to a million each album. So all of us on tour, and far as me and Solo as a learning experience, we learned that we can control our brands as individuals and as a unit. Mm-hmm. We do what the fuck we want to do. We say we want to go out on tour. All right, we all load up. We go out on tour because everyone in our unit is doing something. It's not just one person out the unit doing something and he's carrying everyone else. Everyone out our unit was doing something. So we learned to communicate amongst each other while we were on the road. And I think that's was our downfall when we lost communication with each other.
It's cool because it's all family, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, because we don't even look at it like it's like, yeah, all right, Eric and Paris say, yeah. Just look at it like one big family thing, you know what I'm saying? It's not really like nobody is above nobody. Everybody's just chilling and hanging out.
But how do you lose that communication when there's a brotherhood that's that strong, that creative, and that can reach? Y'all were on different labels, mm-hmm. You know what I mean? We're able to get over that hurdle. Different styles, but still compliment each other, get over that hurdle.
Right.
Different ages.
Right.
You get over, but so the communication should be there. What would break something like that up?
We just wanted to make music and tour the world and inspire people. But with everything you do in life, it has to have a business part of it, control. And I'm very big on quality control now, especially now. And I think we lost that communication of us learning off of each other for our business because it got to a point where E started noticing things like, wait a minute, I'm a big part of this group and I know that, you know, maybe this should be happening for me. But because we wasn't businessmen, it was all kind of just controlled in a certain way where it should have been, you know, equally amongst, you know, won't go deep into detail,
nah,
but that goes into what I was saying in the communication, not just as buddies, but also communicating and learning off each other. No, bottom line is, I don't fuck with nobody now that I can't learn from. Mm. No one is in my circle that I can't learn from or work harder than me, or at least work as hard as me. In the hit squad, we all work hard, but in the business end and the end, it was kind of unequal, and that's where the communication divided. Like, oh, well, wow, you doing this? Well, fuck that, I gotta go get mine. And we lost communication with each other.
Well, the Death Squad is just, we have respect, man. And we ain't on no snitching type, you know what I'm saying? We just strictly, if you got something to say to me, if I don't like the way something don't go down, yo, I don't like the way this go down, why don't we? And everybody's communicating. That's what the Hit Squad lacked last time. That's why so many things got twisted and turned around, because everybody lacked communication and keeping it real.
When you think about that time, though, artists weren't educated on the full spectrum of the business like they are now.
Right.
And then all that information that these artists have today wasn't readily available. You couldn't just go on your phone and find out what splits are and 360s
exactly.
And all of that stuff.
That's right.
So you're finding out what you went through kind of opened up the door for these kids to be like, oh, wait a minute. And I would also think like the Ice Cube situation, I think that's what opened up everyone's eyes to like, oh, this guy can go leave a super group at probably their height.
Yes.
Go off, do incredible music, and now it's looking like, wait a minute, you could do that?
Yes.
You can't leave the group and fall off?
That's like, right. That's right.
You know what I mean? Once that happened with the Hit Squad, the incredible success, y'all kind of did that too. Spliced off.
Yep.
And now you have the Death Squad.
Right.
So y'all did an Ice Cube, basically.
Sorta, yeah, kinda, yeah.
You know?
I wasn't alone, but yeah. But he's part size.
Right. When y'all made the decision to do that, did you know the chemistry was gonna be automatic? What did you think, like, all right, we're about to do this, is this gonna work, though?
Well, at the end of the day, I'm a rider, and I'm very trustworthy, and I'm very loyal. Sometimes that could be my...
To a fault?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It could be my pro and my con, you know, but at the end of the day, I came in with Eric Sermon, and I'm going to leave with Eric Sermon. Eric Sermon was the funk lord. He was one of the main ingredients of EPMD. There were two, but he was more on the production side of EPMD, so I already knew I was going to be straight.
Yeah.
You know, me, and then that's when Keith Murray came in, after we kind of split, and then Keith Murray came along, and we... formed the Death Squad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, but you were already a producer at this time as well?
No, I was producing slightly. Mm-hmm. Like, I know how to maybe make a good 2 beats out of 10, you know? But I learned from the tutelage of Eric Sermon, watching him produce beats, because I wasn't, you know, also just, you know, down with the crew. I was living with E.
Right.
At one time, you know, I was living with E for like maybe three to 4 years.
Wow. Shit,
before I was on my own. So it was just constantly waking up, music, going to sleep, music, records all everywhere. We don't care about nowhere to sleep, you know. It was one time, shit, man. I mean, and that's why that's my nigga too, man, for life, man. Because, you know, at one time, you know, he was living with his road manager in a one-bedroom apartment, and he brought me along to live in there too. And he don't never like sleeping in the bed, so he let me have the bed, and he sleep on the couch, and the road manager sleep on the love seat. Then they switch around. The dedication that we had.
That's love, man. That's,
to do that for like 3 to 4 years, to live on the couch, to live in this space, to create and make an entity.
What do you think he saw in you, though, to do that? Because you're not going to do that to just anybody that you don't grow up with. Like, this, you're a talent that he found.
Right.
And then he's like, I'm going to treat this person like my brother. What made him see that in you?
You know, look at me, my nigga. Like, I'm a hood nigga. Like, I'm a hood nigga, but, you know, I don't look like, you know, even though looks can be deceiving, but I'm a trustworthy dude, you know? I look like I'm about my business. And it all started off from when E met me at a club at Sensations, and we was actually up there talking about another artist, because I was a DJ at the time, but I only had, like, 3 rhymes. To my name, and my boys was rocking for EPMD, you know, and then E asked me to rock. He said, let me hear something from you. And I was like, nah. I turned it down. I was like, nah, I'm just a DJ. I don't want to rap. He's like, all right. And my boys was finished rocking again, and then he came back to me. He was like, nah, let me hear you. He said, give me something. And I was like, fuck it, all right. And I spent one rhyme, man, and that nigga lost his mom, man. And even Parrish told him right there, and I remember this conversation too, because that was like the peak of my life right there. Parrish told him, oh my God, he said, E, if you don't get him, I'm gonna get him. Wow. Because he already had K Solo. So he was like, if you don't get him, I'm gonna get him. He was like, so E brought me on stage that night. What? In my hood, on the club. Imagine always going to this club in your hood, and the star's there one night, and the star bring you on stage and said, yeah, this is my new protege. I farted right on stage. He said, yeah, this is, he was like, yeah, this is, yo, what's your name? What's your name?
I was like, Redman.
What's your name?
Redman.
Yeah, this is Redman. He gonna be rocking with us. So I was like, niggas in the audience, they was looking, they was like, this nigga here. Yo. So at the end of the day, man, yeah. Yeah. Fuck yeah.
So then, boom, you get, now you're going into album mode.
Yeah, album mode. Well, it took years of building, paying dues.
That's the difference between now, though.
Yeah,
well, if something like that, if an artist brings another artist on stage, there's not a process of years before they get on with an album. That they 3-song, 4-song EP is coming out tomorrow.
Oh, well, shit. Well, even with now, with the social media, bruh, you can have an old lady go out here and make a goddamn song in this goddamn place right across right the street here and come right out and she shoot a video and motherfuckers be like, yo, did you see the old lady puffing that weed doing that beat? That beat was hot. And she'd be the hottest new bitch on the motherfucking scene.
What would her name be?
Grandma Lemon Tits. And she just come out there, you heard of that bitch like Grandma Lemon Tits? She rocking, yeah. And she'd be the new shit and labels would be reaching out to her. Who did the beat? Yep. All right, we're gonna sign you to do a 10 song.
It's there.
And that's what it is. But just with our era, we didn't have all that, you know, all those platforms to get the point across.
Yeah.
So we had to, we only had a couple, like MTV, BET.
You was lucky, you know, if
video,
you got on
music
there.
Box, yeah, and these little underground stations, college radio. You know, we ain't had too many outlets.
Yeah.
But we definitely had to pay more dues.
Yeah.
Definitely.
What was the best part about that time, though? Learning your voice, getting your rhymes tight. What was the best time?
The best time about the 90s era to me, which I think was one of the most pivotal eras, no disrespect to any other era, because I'm a huge fan of the 80s era.
Yep.
KRS-One, Big Daddy Kane, Salt and Pepper, MC Light, on down. Milk and Giz, on down. I could Coogee rap, I could go on down. I got them all. Can't and Play. They definitely put everything in perspective of what real hip-hop is, especially Slick Rick. Slick Rick, KRS-One, and Ice Cube, and EPMD, those are my ingredients of Redman.
Yeah.
Just so you know. The 90s era, it was that elevation with the 90s era. From the Sugar Hill Gang to Grandmaster Flash and them planting the seed, to Slick Rick and Salt and Pepper planting the seed, until us from, you know, from me, Busta Rhymes and Tribe Called Quest, planting the seed. In the 90s, it was elevating, more commercial. Coca-Cola commercials was getting more into it. Like, hey, maybe we should check these rap guys out. And it was branching out. Yeah. It was becoming more of a communication of cultures around the world learning about us and what rap is more.
Yeah.
And we did that by exploiting just who we are, not just the rich part of it or the getting money, just the underground of it, the essence of it, of the smoking blunts, the Timberlands out on the block, getting money, coming home, bringing that money to feed your kids, taking care of your kids. You know, we was coming into more of a, you know, more of a rowdy, but more conscience level of where we should be as men. Like I always say, if it wasn't for this hip hop shit, man, we would be lost. Like around the world, culture-wise. Yep. We'll be lost. People wouldn't understand us. You know, Jay helped stamp that too. Like, you know, Biggie helped stamp that. Nas helped stamp that shit. This is who we are. Our culture and what we do is communicating to the little young white kids at home. Or to the little Asian kids at home.
When you went overseas to do shows, or you go over there now, what is that like?
It's even a bigger response.
Mm-hmm.
Because some of the time, you know, people overseas don't understand the language too much, or what you're saying.
But they can say words.
They say the words and they go off energy. Yeah. They really feed off energy. Like, you can be, I've heard big names go over there and just thought they was just, you know, so big that they ain't have to really do nothing. They can just walk around and they got a hot record. But nah, man, they will boo your ass right off the stage. They want to see, they feed off energy. And like, anybody can vouch for me, man. Anybody from the 90s and anybody new that go overseas now, don't matter where you are, from Amsterdam to Germany to Spain, you go there with the right attitude of, like, for example, me and Meth have a cult over there. Like, we can wake up 3 a.m. and say, you know what, we want to go overseas for 2 to 3 months and we want to tour. And that should be done in a week.
Because, scheduled, all the spots,
because,
all that.
Because of not just the energy and great performance we do, but it's the respect that we have for the overseas fans, that we treat them just as equal as American fans, and we don't just do that by talking and saying it in interviews. We go over there and perform and sweat to the bone until they're clapping and standing in ovation like, wow, these motherfuckers came over here and worked. Where to some of these known artists that got a big record on the radio, they came over here and gave a shit and lip singing over the record and all this bullshit. I'm telling you, they notice that shit overseas. If you're young, if you're older, artist, if you're going over there with light work, you go over there giving them light work, they know that shit and they tell us. Yeah. Like, they tell us, they speak. So I advise you to keep your game as equal as you will perform in the States for overseas.
You bring up Method, man, and you gotta understand that Month of Men is probably one of the best, illest, craziest hip hop campaigns for two different artists under the same umbrella.
Right.
You think about, all right, here's a guy from this crew over here with Wu-Tang, here's a guy from this crew, Hit Squad, Def Squad, and they're coming together. They both got Man at the end of their name.
Yep.
They're both at Def Jam.
Yep.
They both kind of look alike. Like, this is insane. And they're both insane, crazy spitters. From what I understand, the industry talk was, y'all didn't even come up with, we're gonna do this.
No.
This is what we're gonna do. And no. I heard it was kind of like pushed on y'all to make this happen, and then it kind of gelled. Are the rumors correct?
Yeah, you're definitely right. You're about 80% right. It wasn't that we denied it. It was just like, hey, that's a good idea. Because we were both young at the time, and we both had singles out. And like you said, we did have a lot of comparisons. It was just at the time, Def Jam came up with a goddamn great idea. Hey, why not have a Month of the Men? And which was a very, very pivotal promotional tour. I mean, that goes down in history. But it was just like a light bulb that just went off. Like, hey, why are we gonna send this guy this way, and we're gonna send this guy this way, and then have him? Because it was a talk of that too, of, you know, they both got records out, and, you know, they need to do their promotional tour, because in the 90s, we actually had to go out and promote and shake hands with people. We couldn't be on the internet introducing our record on Apple Music or be on IG saying we have a fucking new song out, download the link. We actually had to get in a van and drive city to city in major states and cities and go shake hands with radio personalities and fans. We actually had to do that. And we actually had to do that in major cities, from Houston, from Chicago, from the Bay Area, from here. We was on tour buses just to do radio.
That's crazy.
So back to that question is, it wasn't forced on us. It was like an idea. Me and him didn't deny it because we kind of bumped into each other through Def Jam parties. And it was just like, fuck it, we'll be on one van to do this promotional tour. And it was just like, I remember that tour. We did such a great job with each in-store that we did. That's what it was called back in the day, in-store. Because we had to do, you know, we had to greet the fans at a record store. So that was called an in-store.
What's up, Virginian world? What up, people?
Hi.
I'm just the ill type of brother on the mic. I be the brother coming down. I knock the crew up out of sight. Ah.
We did such a great job with dealing with the fans and dealing with the owners of the store till it just traveled. because people like respect. People like a respectable artist and an artist to respect their establishment. And we came off that tour, and the energy that we accumulated on tour from everyone talking, Def Jam said, yo, we might have to do an album.
Wow.
And while we was on tour, me and Meth just started pulling out beats and writing anyway. We was just like, fuck it, you write to this? I was throwing beats on, he was just writing. I was like, all right, that's what I like to hear.
Yeah.
Because I like to get busy, I like to write. And he was just writing, he goes in, we going in, the whole tour. And that's how we came up with the Red MF brand from there, man.
You ever think about how different your life would be if that campaign didn't happen?
Yeah, sometimes I do. And believe us, when we first started teaming up, I'm sure he did, you know, have people like, man, why you teaming up with him? Because I had people like, come on, man, why you teaming up with Meth? I was like, man, fuck that, man. It, because that nigga dope, you know, I looked at him as a young brother because he's younger than me. Mm-hmm. And we had the same views. But one thing I respected about it, why I blocked people out and what they said, and I'm sure he did the same thing, block people out and what they said, because we respected that we can actually come together as a unit and get money and actually go back to our solo careers and get money. So it's like we would work the Red MF brand, and then we would have offers for solo shows just as much. So after we learned that the Red MF brand won't tamper our solo careers, we was just like, boom, full steam, a motherfucking head, nigga.
All the way.
And I don't regret one move that we made. Could we have learned more to excel more? Yes. But then everything is scripted, man, and God has everything in plan. And our career was just nothing but a blessing extra that we can give our family and take care of our kids with. Have this Red MF brand and have the Method Man brand and Red Man brand, Def Squad brand and Wu-Tang brand. You know, you gotta understand. Oof. Like, I mean, Def Squad, we don't move that much because we ain't do that much music besides that one, but Wu-Tang's still moving.
Right.
So, you know, like I could go out as Red MF in my solo, and if Def Squad get a show, I do that. But Meth can go out with Red MF, Method Man, and he goes out with Wu-Tang.
Yeah.
So, you know, that just brought our brands in perspective that no matter where we go, our shit won't be tampered with. We will always remain who we are. And our brand sticks, you know?
All
the
way.
That's just what it is. You know?
What's crazier to me is that the whole Wu-Tang embraced you because of that partnership with Meth to the point where you're like a member of Wu now.
Well, let's get it right. Wu-Tang embraced me back in 92 when I did the Fat Jam thing with Russell Simmons.
Gotcha.
All right? Wu-Tang first came out with Protect Your Neck. And when I first seen those guys and heard that song, I lost my motherfucking mind. I was like, yo, these niggas are incredible. Because they reminded me of what I was missing because of the Hit Squad breaking up. And I was like, see, these niggas is doing it. This is what I want. So they embraced me when I came out to a joint. We did the Fat Jam joint was with me, Onyx, Sweet T, a couple of other artists. Sorry if I don't mention y'all. Forgot I smoke weed and shit. But they embraced me when my intro music was Protect Your Neck. Redman! Say go, Redman! Go, Redman! Go!
I smoke mad Philly blunts and eat pussy for lunch.
Word!
I tickle your clitoris until I'm making you jump.
Word!
Yeah.
And what's your name?
Redman, motherfucker, here to cut you. If the girl's pussy this big, it's just because I fucked up.
You know, because you gotta understand, when Protect Your Neck came out, them niggas was still in the hood, just like I was.
Right.
I ain't get out the hood till my third album, my nigga.
I was
in the projects on Muddy Waters.
No.
I was in the projects. Everybody know near Queensbridge, Woodside Projects.
Wow.
I was still in the projects on the first floor. And you know, the first floor is real hard to live on the first floor. Big rats and roaches down there. But I was in the projects to Muddy Waters. So when they first came out, they were still in the hood and didn't get that much radio play besides college and underground radio.
Yeah.
So when they saw him playing on a Russell Simmons Def Jam platform, them niggas was like, yo, this nigga Red came out to that shit, because Mep told me this story. He was like, yo, ever since then, the brothers embraced you then. I'm proud to say that I'm like the 11th. Remember?
You really are.
Red Man and the W is televised. We ain't the niggas, media telling hella lies.
Even when I work with the Wu-Tang or do songs with the Wu-Tang, I never ask for money. I never, get a check or anything. I do it for the love, and I did a lot of work for Wu-Tang and with Wu-Tang.
Open that the new album? Are you the first one on the chat? You opened the album.
I think so.
Wu-Tang album opened by Redman.
Yeah, man. So because I feel I'm a member, and they feel I'm a member as well. And I'm definitely a rider. But at the end of the day, they're my brothers. I never ask for a dime. I don't want a dime. I just feel privileged to be a part of a super group again.
That's dope.
To get that love that I miss. What I'm talking about?
That's dope. One of the things that's been floating around the internet for the last few years, but it really blew up recently, was when Nas posted a picture of him and Tupac is in there, but then you're in it as well. You're in that thing. What was going on? What was that time? That picture is iconic. Do you remember where you guys were? Do you remember that?
We was in New York, uptown, I think, somewhere. I don't really remember too much from them because I was smoking a lot then. But from the looks of it, and usually when I see a picture of something, it kind of gives me flashbacks of that time and memory. It was a great time in hip hop because, Nas was, because from that picture, it looked like Nas was either on his first album or coming off of the barbecue with Large Professor. We were all there with different mentalities, but with the same mentality of we're in hip hop and this is something we gotta build. And this is something that feels new, and it's a great communication with everyone because, Nas, Pac, Biggie, and me, we are definitely different, different fields of kind of hip hop, even though it's same, aggressive.
Yeah.
But it's different, platforms of it on how we talk about it. And at that picture, what I see and what I get a flashback of is we all have our attitude. We all cocky. Like, yeah, I'm Nas, nigga. And the Nas picture is big up to Nas, first of all. Nas, people don't know. Like, I only knew, a couple of people in the industry at first. And Nas is one of them, man. He'll tell you, Nas, I knew Nas way back, man. I used to go get blunts for Nas way back in when he lived in Long Island. So big up to Nas. That's my dude, man. In that picture, I see each of us with our own cockiness, with our own swag of saying, yeah, we the new ones. It feels like a picture of the new XXL cover, like, yeah, we the new guys and shit.
Yeah,
that's what it feels like. And just recently that Nas picture popped up. Like, it always been that Tupac, Biggie, and me picture. But then recently that Nas picture popped up, which brought a shock to the to the world, wow, Nas was actually there too. So that even made me feel good, wow.
Yeah.
Cause I was like, shit, man, if I die, that picture gonna be grand.
Still there.
But now I got another nigga they gotta wait on too. So when me and Nas pass away, that picture is gonna be grand.
Yo.
But yeah.
You mentioned passing away. I don't want us to get morbid or anything, but what do you think about with your legacy and who you are and what you've done with your life, at least up until this point, and what you think people would think about you when you're gone?
Well, it's important to me of what my family and friends think first and then what the people think. And I know now, if I was to pass right now, because I think about that sometimes, because tomorrow's never promised. And I live with that consciousness of when I wake up in the morning, I think, thank you for waking me up today. God damn, thank you for waking me up. I even curse a little bit. Thank you, Lord. He know I'm funny, so me and God got a close relationship, so don't worry about
that's it. That's real.
So when I think about if I pass right now, what mark and what feeling of temperature would I leave on my family and friends and then fans is that I know my kids to say, he always told us about this day. He always said, look, be prepared in case something happened. I know they're weak, but they'll remember a lot of shit that I talked about and tried to teach them and how tentative I was for them to learn to be better than me. They're gonna know that Dad always said he wanted us to be better than him, and in order for us to be better than him, we had to work twice as harder than him. So they're gonna leave with a good message. So is my friends. But the like my fans, they're gonna be left with the understanding, like, you know, he was a great fucking artist and he had fun what he did. He loved what he did. And he never changed for no one. He never subjected his style or his brand for no one. Not the new wave, not for no brand of business. He always kept his brand neutral and respectable and fun and lyrical and all the good elements of being an MC. He kept that element, and I'm gonna miss him for that because it wasn't too many people that's doing what I'm doing. You know, something like me missing is like a big toe. Have you ever? I broke my little toe.
I broke my big toe.
I broke my little toe. I ain't even break the big one. I broke the little toe. And nigga, I was in pain, ready to just cut my foot off. Like, you know what? I can't walk. And I didn't know how much balance and how much a little toe can
it'll throw you off.
Can fuck up your life.
Yeah.
So I'm like that toe. That missing toe, like, damn, we're gonna miss that toe.
Yeah.
Because we used to have an eargasm off his music. He brought an element of rap that I love and appreciate. He brought that aggressiveness. I'ma miss that eargasm. I'ma miss Reggie Redman, that big toe, that little toe.
Yeah, yeah.
That was nicely put. Right?
That was beautiful.
Sweet.
But the crazier part is, it's almost like you're being born again by coming out with this new music.
This black man made it in America. Basketball and rap attract kids to get the hell out the area. Nowadays, niggas kill when you get ahead of them.
And when we were speaking earlier, you know, with Ya, it's like, we hear something that we missed. Cause I was like, what was the first thing I said? I was like, yo, those drums are crazy. And you riding right over those drums.
Check that out, I'm on them like, yeah. Redman Grammy nominated. And I still feel I ain't made it. So I'm taking over like, yeah.
That's what I love on Rated R.
Right.
I had a fight with Chuck, the punk motherfucker. Tried to stab me in the gut, so I dazed him with an uppercut. Snapped the neck on Michael Myers, then I freaked it. Cause it was August and he was talking his trick or treat shit.
And that's what, 92?
Mm-hmm.
And then I started breaking down artists' careers. And you start thinking about, all right, the most successful artists have been the ones that were consistent throughout at least an 8-year period. And you know, from 92 to about 2000, 2001, you were dropping the joint every other year. Boom,
yes.
Boom. When you think about Kendrick's career, from 2009, 10, every other year, boom.
Yep.
He's right there.
Dropping.
You're on schedule. Is that conscious or is that the label or is that you saying like, all right, here's these times, and then there's that gap.
Mm-hmm.
You get a little older.
Yeah.
Life hits.
Yes.
Kids,
yes,
family, kid, all
yep,
that.
Yep.
But then you want it back again.
Yeah.
And exactly. Now you're at that back again joint.
Yeah. I look at it as that I'm back again in a new wave. To my fans and to my peers, you know, I never left. The only thing difference is that Red and Meth were, we were under Def Jam, and this is like our fifth year of being independent, but like for 21 years, man, we was under Def Jam, man. Like we was, even in our early 2000s, we was under Def Jam. So after we got from under the umbrella, we were quiet in a sense of learning this social media game, this new game, this new independent game. Because even the independent game had changed up.
All the way.
It changed up from the Master P days.
Yep.
You know, everything changes, so.
Because it was more like, be independent to get to the major league.
Exactly.
Now it's like, be independent.
Exactly, exactly. So it wasn't just us just learning, it was also our media circle tuning in with the times of, this is social media, look, all right, I know we 90s niggas and fuck that, we ain't fucking with social media, but this is the time. And, you know, we either gotta get with it or we're gonna be left behind.
Yeah.
And so we was, within those 5 years, we were learning and adjusting and saying, not just adjusting and learning, but adjusting, saying mentally, like, you know what? Fuck it, this is the new wave, I'm gonna get with it. So, you know, within those 5 years, yeah, it was a little hiatus, but it was a hiatus period of learning.
And but it's a hiatus that came off the fact that you had another artist running Def Jam.
When Jay-Z came into Def Jam to be a CEO, like I say, man, fuck that. At the end of the day, he didn't want to see a brand like Def Jam, an entity like Def Jam, just go to shit without him at least taking a crack at it.
Right.
So, you know, like at the end of the day, I said, I respect that man, Jay, for taking the time out to even, you know, saying, you know, I'm a run this shit for a minute and I'm gonna help y'all artists as much as I can.
It was a tough time for you, but you also respect the timing and all
absolutely
of that stuff. Yeah, yeah. But now, since you're known to be, you know, with the label of Def Jam behind you for so many years, what's your label now?
I don't have a label now. I just put out records through RIVETING Entertainment. Like I said earlier in my previous conversation, I like working with guys that work harder than me or even, you know, just as hard as me and that I can learn from as well. And, you know, these guys at RIVETING Entertainment showed me nothing but love since day one. And they're all about executing and putting out the execution of a product. You know, hey, they give you your freedom. Hey, do what you do. Hey, let's execute it. And when you could come together with someone that you barely know, like Scott and Drew of RIVETING, and they just execute and believe in your product, because they got new artists that they deal with, and they're younger than me, you know? But when you got any platform that's still giving artists like me a platform to still put out music from the 90s, I just think it's just great, and I just love the respect and the communication that we have.
Y'all rocking right now, man.
Yeah, yeah, we rocking. We having fun. Yeah. At the end of the day, you have to have fun with this shit.
That's real. And you're having fun on social media. You're having a lot of fun on social media. Yo, your car drives, I love it. When I see the little thumb, the little thumbnail picture, and you in the car, I'm like, oh, this is going to be something crazy.
Yeah.
Because you either shouting out a rapper or you bugging out to a new tune or whatever. Uh-huh. How has social media helped you?
I was on social media earlier, before my manager just said, all right, you know what, you're right, we got to do the social media.
Now. Yeah.
And even Meth, like, Meth don't fuck, he can't stand social media.
Yeah,
he don't like social media. He don't fuck with social media, even though he got social media.
Like, he's on the alert.
He don't fuck with social media. I got in tune with social media because of, I like exploiting my work habits. As you see on my IG, it's all about work. I talk about work. You got to work, nigga. We working.
Love the work. Got to fucking work. We working.
I'm working, nigga.
I like exploiting my work habits, not in a show-off manner, but to inspire.
Yep.
I love to inspire through music. I love to inspire through energy. I love to show people how blessed I am. I got the light on me all the time. Evil, negative energy is bouncing off of me because I believe and I have that faith of where I'm going. And I like to exploit that in a positive way where people be like, yo, my nigga, every time I watch that work video, I be like, yo, fuck that, I gotta get on my job. Whether you a doctor, a lawyer, or sweeping the motherfucking floor, nigga, I want my videos to inspire you. And I love IG. That's my favorite one. No hate to Twitter. I'm not on Snap or none of that young shit. I don't do none of the young shit.
It's just something about IG, right?
It's just something about IG. It's just so authentic. And I love IG. I love Twitter. My Facebook, I'm tuned in as well. But IG, I inspire through there. And I love my social media, man. I love my fans on there because I started off on one. I remember I had niggas around my way that had, like, you know, 2,000 when I had one. And I was like, all right, fuck it. I'm going to start here. And when I got to 100K, I was good. I was like, yo, I don't need no more. I'm like, yo, I could just deal with my 100,000 fans, and I'm good. But that shit started progressing more, and they started tuning in more of what I was doing. And I can honestly say that my Twitter and my IG or my Facebook are, they're organically grown.
Of course.
They're honest fans. I pay for no extra shit or nothing. I don't even know how to pay for extra followers or nothing. But all my shit is organically grown because they like, yes, one of our favorites is still doing it.
Yeah, man. Yeah. One of the other things that we have to touch on real quick is the fact that you're at these music festivals and you're driving the carts back and forth for the artists to get to the stage and to their joints.
Such an experience.
Yo, which is crazy because you would think you're doing it as a joke.
No.
But that was real deal business.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah.
Well, to touch on that, and just so happens, my boy Josh, you know, who was my engineer as well, he worked festivals.
Yeah.
You know, he has a, you know, he'd been working festivals for a while, so he got a good placement in different big festivals. And I always told him, like, damn, man, you know, I'm with one of the driver recording festivals. He was like, yo, man, you could drive for the Brooklyn Festival. Randall's Island Festival.
There we go.
I went to Brooklyn, because he works the Brooklyn Festival, too. So he said either or. And my first job was with the Randall's Island family, the Randall's Island Festival. And I drove that cart for the first time at a festival, very, very intrigued and willing to learn. Because, like you said, people might see me on that cart and be like, oh, she didn't know you on the Cody. Yeah, before. No, I was actually, I'm a kind of dude that like to start from the bottom.
Right.
And work my way up. I don't like to start all the way from here talking about I'm the man and trying to progress because your downfall is waiting for you when you start there. Just being behind the stage, to the smallest detail I like learning about, you know. I can help on the stage and, you know, help with artists, but the cart is where you just get to really see a lot. And it's therapeutic for me. I'm not taking no money from them. So I'm starting from the carts to learn how to move to stage manager, how to move to these right
So you're looking
placements.
At the mechanics of the whole operation.
I'm trying to learn it from mechanics. Everything starts from the ground up. So once you get in good with the people with the carts, the ground niggas, the ground, then you move your way up. So the cart driving was an experience to learn behind the stage and what the cart drivers go through.
Yeah.
And honestly, sometimes, like this time I drove the cart this year, and I had a scarf on. So, so they didn't know who was driving them. And I'm gonna tell you like this on some real shit, not to fall off subject.
Right now, real.
But this world, y'all communication level is fucked up right now because they didn't know who I was.
Yeah.
I was just a black dude driving a cart. And man, niggas get funky with you.
Yo.
Ooh, woo.
Like, yo, hurry up type shit, or?
I am just so blessed. Thank you, God, for making me who I am, that I have the upper hand to look outside and in of making money and being a regular person.
Mm.
And I had to, like I said, I had the scarf on, so I was a regular person to people getting in the cart.
But was that a test that you were doing?
It wasn't a test. It was just so happens it was a lot of dust.
Yeah.
Because of the different carts that was coming in and out that, you know, if you ain't, you know, I didn't want to be sneezing and shit. So I had to, you know, the bandana over my mouth.
You're not going to be like, yo, I'm Redman.
And I'm not going to do that. So I'm picking up people in the back of my cart and they not know who I am. And man, the funky level, it was respectful. But it was just like, yeah, I'm going over here to stage two. All right, my nigga. I was like, all right, come on, man, y'all ready? Shaking their hand, they like,
whoa.
I'm like, oh. And
whoa.
And a couple of them, I ended up rolling up without the mask at another spot. They seen me later. They was like,
oh, shit. This is Redman.
That was Redman all this fucking time.
That's crazy.
And I know they checked themselves and felt like I was a tad bit funky with this guy.
Hey, they knew. That was a lesson, though. That's a lesson.
I was a tad bit funky with this guy.
Yep.
And that was Redman. And because I'm a real nigga for, at the end of the day.
Already.
So I build off, and I feel off energy. And I can feel when they coming over like, yo, my nigga, you one of my...
Oh.
And I'll be like, don't worry about it, my nigga. I had the mask on. Don't worry about it.
You had to let him down.
But yeah, man. The car thing, getting back to your question, the car thing was a learning experience. I had fun with the staff, the Randall's Island staff. They do that festival every year. They allowed me to work every year now.
That's
and
not only that to make this story longer, but I also did it to tap in to the new artists. Mm.
So you kicking it with them, going back and forth.
I had to drop some of the new artists, yeah. like Childish Gambino, everybody.
What's the conversation like?
It wasn't a conversation. It was like, wow, you.
They can't believe it.
Oh,
they thinking it's a show
with,
or something like
that. Oh, shit. Now, some of their entourage, some of their young niggas in there, I can tell they don't know and shit, because they cocky, they new niggas, so they like, who this Redman? You never heard of Redman? No, I never heard of Redman. And I hear that, and I'm like, you know, it's cool, because I was cocky when I was young, too. But one thing about our motherfucking era, we was the baddest motherfuckers, but we loved the niggas before us. We highly respected the era before us, from Rakim to Big Daddy Kane on down. So at the end of the day, I was just tapping in.
Legendary career, legendary spot on TV from MTV Cribs. Everybody runs up to you and talks about that, or ha-ha. The one thing, though, everyone knows you for the weed. Are people still trying to smoke you out, man?
People still trying to smoke me out. Because of the marijuana background I have, But it's more of not just smoking me out, but letting me test the quality of weed, because we have a lot of growers out here now.
Yep.
Since the industry of the marijuana game that excelled, we have a lot of growers out here that just want to just bless us. Like, yo, always wanted to give y'all some bud or smoke a blunt with y'all. And the smoke a blunt with me thing, Redman, first of all, Redman don't share blunts no more. So I'm going to put that out there. So when y'all coming on and say, yo, I want to smoke a blunt with you, think about just what I said in this interview. We ain't smoke and share the blunt with each other in over like 5 to 7 years,
you're
10
bugging.
Years. We don't share blunts with people. We give people weed to smoke. Mm. But mostly it's like we want to smoke a blunt with you, or we want to give you some bud.
Well, back in the day, I was telling you I was at the session for Run for Cover, and I got offered some weed by you, and I passed up because I wasn't smoking, and I told people on IG. So now after we end this, we're going to have to let them kind of find out if I got a chance or not.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Like I said, I don't share my goddamn drinks. We can roll up one and top one like we're drinking, like, yeah, cheers.
Bomb.
Yeah, but one of the reasons I stopped sharing my blunts as well, because I smoke in backwards, and backwards don't roll up too well, you know, because of the veins, and backwards smokers know what I'm talking about, but you can roll it backward to suit you. And most of the time, I'm talking with my backward hanging out my mouth, which leave a lot of wetness at the tip of it. And I don't want no other nigga juices on the end of my backward when I'm smoking. So I just keep that shit to myself.
Thank you once again, Red.
Yes, sir. That's what we're here for, man.
That's what we're here for, man.
Hey, yo, listen, man, the new album, Muddy Waters, is coming out. Please stay in tune with that, man. Follow me on IG at Redman Gilla, that's Redman, G-I-L-L-A, or at The Real Redman on Twitter, or on my Facebook. I forgot what the fuck that was, but you'll find it through my Twitter and IG.
We'll get to this week. Yeah. Yeah.
I said I smack the shit out you if your mouth out of line. I want a burial ass, but I'm